Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the final of our Gender Studies lecture series for this academic year. The Gender Studies program here at Westmont is a very interdisciplinary program. Professors from all over campus in various departments teach as part of the Gender Studies program, and the lecture series this year has highlighted work from across campus. Professors from sociology, from English, from religious studies, from theater, and tonight again from English, have presented as part of this series to explore some of the work that they're doing, connecting the basic ideas of gender, the themes of gender, with their different fields of study. Tonight's speaker returns us to the English department and the world of literature. Please come on in. There's plenty of seats over here. Now that you're being identified, you have to come in. So tonight's lecture returns us to the English department and the world of literature. Dr. Cheri Larsen Hoeckley holds a doctorate in English from the University of California at Berkeley. She's taught at Westmont since 1997 in the English department and is chair of the department right now. But that's not all. She's also led multiple trips across Europe and England. How many of you have been on Northern Europe or England semester with Dr. Larsen Hoeckley? Yeah. She's the guiding force behind the reinvigoration of the Gender Studies program here at Westmont. So really, the reason that you're all sitting here in this room tonight is because of the speaker in more ways than just one. She's also the coordinator of the Gender Studies program, just for kicks. She organizes the marathon reading program here at Westmont to explore the joy of the novel and to revel in the pleasure of reading for a long time. If you've been lucky enough to take her classes, then you know she is an inspiring and an inspired lecturer. You're probably unsurprised to know that she has been honored by the Award of Teacher of the Year in the Humanities Department here at Westmont. She researches and writes in her spare time on women writers from throughout the spectrum of English novelists, and she'll be sharing some of her research with us tonight. Her talk is titled Marriage Law Reform, Singleness, and Middlemarch. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Larsen Hoeckley.
Thank you, Karen. That was very kind. I have one correction. I actually co-coordinate gender studies. Dr. Reeder is my partner in making all these things happen and usually the one who notices what we need to do. So thanks, Karen. I thought I had this all figured out and now I'm looking around things. There we go. I just have to say, it's really fun to be here talking about a book that many of you know I love to the point of obsession, with several people who I love nearly to the point of obsession. So thanks for being here tonight. One of my favorite Victorian scholars, Gillian Beer, claims that it may be easier to talk about what's not in Middlemarch than it is to actually talk about what's there. Capaciousness, Gillian Beer writes, is one of the book's most marked features. A few of you are well acquainted with George Eliot's capacious novel because I've assigned it to you. A few of you I know are in the middle of it and you've been told you can't finish yet because we're reading it serially. I'm going to try not to give away too much of the ending. I suspect when I first said in early January you can only read this one part at a time, it felt like a small mercy, and now I suspect it's beginning to feel a little bit more like a challenge not to read ahead. So I'm honoring that I've told you you can't read the end yet, and I'm going to try not to spill all the beans. Okay. Some of you I know have read the novel closely more than once, and I've had a lot of pleasure of talking about the novel with you in those cases, and I'm looking forward to a little more of that conversation tonight. If you've read the novel, you might remember that marriage law reform, from my title, is one of those things that overlaps with Gillian Beer's title as something that's not in Middlemarch. Okay. At least it's not explicitly mentioned in the novel. However, concerns with the shortcomings of Victorian marriage law is one of those multitudinous things that the novel explores with a kind of pointed implicitness, and that prompts Professor Beer's rather unusual literary claim that we ought to try to talk about what's not in Middlemarch as the easier task. So tonight my hope is to make a little bit more explicit this novel's implicit interest in explorations of marriage law and of alternatives of traditional Victorian domesticity that I see the novel pressing on its very careful readers. Since many of those thoughts are the product of having taught Eliot's novel at Westmont, or to adapt her term for the novel to our very real campus with the description she uses for her fictional city, that it's got a particular web. This web, that's to say, of social interactions at Westmont, where I've taught this novel repeatedly for the last 18 years, is one that I find many of these issues still speak to over 100 years later. The novel has much to say to us in response to the kinds of questions and comments that I hear on this campus about marriage, and also to the concerns that seem to haunt some of those questions, but that I don't hear asked often enough about singleness. Those reforming comments from Eliot, though often oblique, are undoubtedly behind Virginia Woolf's well-known assessment of Middlemarch as one of the few novels written for grown-up people. So it's a pleasure to talk with all of you grown-up people this evening about how the novel explores the possibilities and the hurdles of reforming Victorian marriage law, and the equal possibilities that legal reform alone will never mend the limits for of life for women like Dorothea Brooke. So I look forward very much to the conversation afterward. I'm going to try to be done fairly soon and leave a lot of time for what I hope will be questions from you. What is Middlemarch? When the novel was first published, readers asked that question, unsure of whether the title referred to a person, a place, a time, or a thing as yet undiscovered. Here, for instance, is Middlemarch. In its lithograph t-shirt version, the entire text of the novel, written around a reverse shadow of Dorothea Brooke and her not-so-vital husband, Professor Kasabin. Okay. In an age of eponymous heroes and heroines, think Jane Eyre, David Copperfield, Oliver Twist, Mary Barton, even Jude the Obscure, readers began the first monthly part of Middlemarch, and here it is as it originally came out. You'd get one of those paper volumes spread out, or 4 months spread out over 8 months, people began the first part potentially expecting to meet a hero with the family name Middlemarch. In defiance of these expectations for a male hero, the novel opens with a prelude, an unusual term for literature, recalling readers' collective memory of Teresa of Avila, who we'll talk about a little bit more, and then turns to a young heroine, not yet 20, and named not anything Middlemarch, but Dorothea Brooke, whom we're told was, quote, enamored of intensity and greatness and rash in embracing whatever seemed to her to have those aspects, likely to seek martyrdom and then to make retractions and then to incur martyrdom after all in a quarter where she had not sought it. Okay. So there's not much enlightenment on the identity of Middlemarch in the opening chapters of the novel. We meet this incredibly earnest young woman. It's not until Chapter 6, when Dorothea is engaged already, and her uncle hosts a celebration in her honor, that the onomatopoetically, I knew I wasn't going to be able to say that the first time, named Reverend's wife, Mrs. Cadwallader, informs us that the industrial town near Dorothea's family estate actually gives the novel its name. And here is a fictional representation of Middlemarch, or a representation of fictional Middlemarch. Okay. We quickly begin to apprehend that the town matters as much as our prone-to-renunciation heroine, because we can't understand Dorothea without understanding the particular web that shaped her. In short, to borrow the narrator's witty description, the world of Middlemarch is a world where, quote, women were expected to have weak opinions, but the great safeguard of society and of domestic life was that opinions were not acted on. Sane people did what their neighbors did, so that if any lunatics were at large, one might know and avoid them. Sane people did what their neighbors did, and women had weak opinions that they did not act on. That same, often arch narrator invests ample time to help us understand, along with your other readers, that this particular web is a highly normative web, a web of landed estates surrounding a cloth manufacturing center, where political reform is about to bring more universal male suffrage, and where that reform has just legally declared more equality between Christian denominations. It's also a place that has yet to encounter the reform that the novel's readers have in common in the condition of women by reforming marital property law and divorce law. The novel has a very nostalgic tone because it's set in the 1830s and written in the 1870s. So it's a novel that middle-aged people would remember as their childhood, and in a time that in many ways is thought of as simpler because it was a time before these legal reforms happened. George Eliot, oops, and there she is. She. George Eliot's interest in marriage law is, on the surface, surprising. She lived most of her life not legally married. Her anomalous status as a Victorian woman, though, seems to have uniquely positioned the person we call George Eliot to understand the need for legal and social reforms in marriage practices. The novelist George Eliot was born Marianne Evans in rural Warwickshire. Her mother died when she was in her teens, and she returned from her evangelical boarding school in early adulthood to keep house for her widowed father. After her father retired from managing an estate, the two of them returned to rural Coventry, where she met a circle of self-described free thinkers who appealed to her intense intellectual fervor and whose conversations caused serious conflict with the faith of her youth. In her early 20s, she began translating German theology, just for fun, and fell into what she called the holy wars with her father. A truce in this conflict finally came when she agreed to attend church with him every Sunday, and he agreed not to question her about her thinking or her writing or her faith. When her father died in 1849, she moved to London and took over editorial duties for the thriving intellectual journal, The Westminster Review. Under the tutelage of the nominal editor John Chapman, Eliot, as a young woman, controlled the means to publication for a circle of Victorian literati that included John Stuart Mill, Herbert Spencer, Harriet Martineau, Thomas Huxley, and the essayist George Henry Lewes. Because Lewes had given his family name to the three children his wife Agnes had with Thornton Leigh Hunt after Lewes and Agnes separated, Victorian marriage law determined that he had condoned her adultery, and divorce was no longer legally available to George and Agnes by the time he met Marianne Evans, so they had not been living together for years. When George Henry Lewes and Marianne Evans decided to travel to Weimar alone together for his health in July of 1854, they clearly understood the social consequences of their choice, especially for Marianne, who was now spelling her name with an I and an A, rather than as it was spelled for her birth name. When they returned to London, Lewes and Evans set up a shared household. She began to insist that her friends write to her as Mrs. Lewes, and the couple lived together uninterruptedly as companions in authorship and in life until George Lewes died in 1878. Her older brother did not speak to her again from the time that she returned from the continent until after Lewes' death, when she married her attorney, John Cross, just months before she died. So we call George Eliot George Eliot because it's a little hard to decide what other name you would use for this woman if you didn't, and her pseudonym has stuck. In 1871, Eliot wrote from the vantage point of her awareness that the industrial age and various political reforms were demanding, more aptly than simply allowing for, elasticity in the brittle legal construction of the nuclear family at mid-century. Her own perspective and experience prompted Eliot's vision that the patriarchy, more than civil society generally, benefited from normative formations of traditional nuclear families. Nothing in the biography of George Eliot, or Marianne Evans Lewes, in other words, suggests that she was opposed to lifelong monogamous heterosexual unions. In fact, by whatever name we decide to call her, the author of Middlemarch and lifelong companion of George Henry Lewes made considerable social and economic sacrifices to maintain her own lifelong partnership, which she called a marriage. We do see evidence in her biography and in Middlemarch that she was actually aware of the many ways that laws in support of marriage that were putatively the bulwark of civil and religious society often actually pulled at the threads of that society with unjust demands on men as well as on women. Those demands, Eliot knew, could be as invested in controlling the passage of property and the productivity of women, both married and single, as they were in protecting the covenants between couples that made companionate marriage thrive, as Eliot's relationship with Lewes did for both of their lives. Marriage law reform by the late 1860s, when Eliot was working on Middlemarch, had prompted some changes Eliot saw as beneficial. But she recognized that as a novelist, she had a more complex task as a reformer. As she described that project at one point in her letters, she would only succeed as a novelist if she helped her readers to, and this is a quote that comes up in Eliot's studies often, to be better able to imagine and to feel the pains and joys of those who differ from themselves in everything but the broad fact of being struggling, erring human beings. How, you may be asking, does a largely agnostic novelist help creatures to less suffering and more thriving in civil society with religious reform? Her method, as other Eliot critics have long described, was to create the particulars of real, or at least realistic, characters, and to encourage her readers in narrative passages to draw general conclusions for their own lives. As a thematic backdrop for that particular fictional representation of the limits of marital normativity in Middlemarch, Eliot reviews or re-sees Christian history that's often read as providing the foundation for an understanding of universal heterosexual marriage as the grounding of civil society. So, we have a novel that explores what Eliot calls the domestic epic, that's her term, by beginning with the reforming Carmelite nun, St. Teresa of Avila. As we're indebted to the onomatopoetically named Mrs. Cadwallader for the confirmation of the identity of Middlemarch, we are also indebted to the loquacious reverend's wife for linking Eliot's critique of marriage to the outmoded social structure that the narrator believes needs reconsideration, the monastery. However, the vicar's bold wife misinterprets some important features of convent life when she tells her neighbor Sir James that Dorothea's marriage to Casaubon is, quote, as good as going to a nunnery. On the contrary, Eliot's prelude to the novel makes clear that Dorothea's marriage to an egocentric, aging scholar might drive her to isolation and celibacy, but that union fails colossally in offering the intellectual, spiritual, and communal benefit that a nunnery has held for many women in the history of Christendom. The wise narrator, speaking, unlike Mrs. Cadwallader, from above the painfully limited truths of provincial Middlemarch, reflects the novel's prelude on St. Teresa, who famously not only went to a nunnery, but reformed a whole order of them. The novel's opening meditation provides Eliot with a framework for examining the limits of the novel as a reforming work. Through her narrative of St. Teresa and the contrast of Teresa with the saintly Dorothea, Eliot also challenges her audience to prepare for conditions that will allow women to develop a vocation uniquely suited to their gifts and their circumstances, rather than burying those gifts in fantasies of marriage described for them too often in novels. While distancing herself from traditional marriage plots, the narrator makes repeated references to Christian art, which Eliot knew through the work of her acquaintance Anna Murphy Jameson. In beginning the series of visual allusions with Teresa, the prelude points specifically to the church, both as a current force in stifling women's potential, and yet contrastingly as a historically demonstrated source of hope for women's vocation and for richer flourishing in both civil and religious society. I've got a few copies of the prelude, which is what I'm going to refer to quite a bit tonight, the opening section of Middlemarch, on a handout. You're probably going to need to share them if you know the prelude. It was just too big to put on a single frame, or there's too much of it to put on a single frame. This is about two pages that open the novel that Eliot chose to label with a musical term rather than a fictional one. Eliot gives her readers ample history of the 16th century Catholic reformer for them to weave St. Teresa's story into Middlemarch. She begins slyly, coercing her readers' attention by placing them in the realm of the intellectually curious, taking the assumptive posture that we are like anyone who, quote, cares much to know the history of man and how the mysterious mixture behaves under the varying experiments of time. In continuing, she further assumes that her readers would have dwelt at least briefly on Teresa's story. So anybody with any curiosity clearly has thought for a while about St. Teresa. While 21st century readers may remember Teresa as a mystic and as the subject of Gian Bernini's erotic marble altarpiece, The Ecstasy of St. Teresa, Eliot chooses to concentrate first on the childhood zeal of Teresa and on her reform activities, such as establishing a convent and reforming nuns in the Carmelite order. As we move through the novel, Eliot's narrator makes clear that it's not so much that ecstatic devotion is wrong. More precisely, in an increasing secular culture of the late 19th century, ecstatic devotion is too often the only narrative available to women. For the narrator, this trend is more damaging because husbands have often replaced God as the object of that devotion. Of course, we don't leave St. Teresa in the prelude to Middlemarch. She remains through the finale when the domestic epic concludes with what the narrator insists are new beginnings of marriages. Even in that traditionally happy closure, the narrator laments that, quote, a new Teresa will hardly have the opportunity of reforming a conventual life because the medium in which her ardent deeds took shape is forever gone. Those ardent deeds, again, seem to be communal acts for the benefit of other Christian women in her own age and beyond that age, not the singular focused devotion of mystical experience or of romantic fulfillment that Dorothea finally achieves. But, the narrator warns her reader in the final pages, we insignificant people, with our daily words and acts, are preparing the lives of many Dorotheas, some of which may present a far sadder sacrifice than that of the Dorothea whose story we know. The narrator then insists that Teresa's story carries vital lessons, as young women continue to look for means to engage their ardent souls, all too often in a passionate attachment to a single person, when their zeal might be better directed to a more thoughtful, communal project. In the 600 pages, and there's at least that many, between the prelude and the finale, lest the reader miss the resonance between the ardent 16th century Catholic reformer and the novel's early 19th century Protestant heroine, the narrator frequently connects Dorothea to images from Christian art. For instance, as Dorothea first expresses her attraction to Casaubon, the narrator recalls Teresa, particularly in her desire for intellectual growth and productivity. For the sake of time tonight, I'm not going to walk through all these Teresa references, but there are many of them in the novel. Following Gillian Beer's lead instead, we'll focus on one that highlights what Dorothea lacks, or what's not in Middlemarch, that Teresa experienced in early modern Spanish convent life. Through a lengthy passage, as Dorothea contemplates her marriage to Casaubon, the narrator reveals the paucity of options available to an enthusiastic and intellectually engaged young woman like Dorothea. Particularly, the narrative reveals how naively Dorothea looks to Casaubon as her only hope for spiritual and intellectual enrichment. And let me just give you that passage. Oh, that's Anna Jameson, the art historian who Eliot leans on and who will be there. And this one we'll come back to. Many of you, I think, might know the Bernini sculpture. I want to talk about it again, but there's one glimpse at it and we'll come back. Okay. Here's the first Teresa passage that I want to look at. That more complete teaching would come. Mr. Casaubon would tell her all that. She was looking forward to higher initiation in ideas as she was looking forward to marriage and blending her dim conceptions of both. It would be a great mistake to suppose that Dorothea would have cared about any share in Mr. Casaubon's learning as mere accomplishment, for though opinion in the neighborhood of Freshett and Tipton had pronounced her clever, that epithet would not have described her to circles in whose more precise vocabulary cleverness implies mere aptitude for knowing and doing, apart from character. Intelligent and generous-spirited though she might be, Dorothea undeniably lacks clear motives for marriage. Dorothea's dim conceptions of both marriage and learning will gain no clarity from anyone in her community of Middlemarch. If the extent of Dorothea's community's imagination, as the narrator tells us here, never sees female knowledge as a significant character virtue, then Casaubon may well be Dorothea's best chance for intellectual Christian community, and that's a sobering thought. The narrator knows that her community's more elaborate sense of the duties of a wife will overwhelm anyone's ability to imagine her gaining the higher initiation in ideas that Dorothea hopes for, even if the pedantic Casaubon were likely to provide that entree. When the narrative turns back to the mode of free and direct speech, or melding Dorothea's thought patterns with the narrator's linguistic control and authority, the dangerous extent of Dorothea's limited circumstances and her limitless ardor and aspiration come into full view. The novel tells us that all her eagerness for acquirement lay within that full current of sympathetic motive in which her ideas and impulses were habitually swept along. She did not want to deck herself with knowledge, to wear it loose from the nerves and blood that fed her action. And if she had written a book, she must have done it as St. Teresa did, under the command of an authority that constrained her conscience. But something she yearned for, by which her life might be filled with action at once rational and ardent. And since the time was gone by for guiding visions and spiritual directors, since prayer heightened yearning but not instruction, what lamp was there but knowledge? Surely learned men kept the only oil, and who more learned than Mr. Casaubon? Who more learned than Mr. Casaubon? Clearly the limits of Dorothea's knowledge are considerable. Not only does her enthusiastic desire collapse matrimony and intellectual categories, but it also presses her beyond what any Protestant Victorian religious institution is prepared to offer her in guidance, and into the rigid arms of Professor Kasavin. For want of the Christian community Teresa had, the lamp to guide her path, and the directors to guide her vision, Dorothea finds marriage her only dim hope for education or to an outlet for her reforming desires. In her provincial circle, the dry Kasavin keeps the only light, the only oil that will light Dorothea's way to an intellectual or rewarding life. Her misperceptions about her intended spouse do not make Dorothea unique in Middlemarch. There's plenty of that to go around in town. It's her desire for a partner in reform projects that makes her unusual. The deep sadness of Dorothea's unusual female desires becomes clear when her marriage brings an end to the only reform she's quixotically managed so far, and that is improving cottages on the estate of Tipton. Actually, she hasn't managed to improve them. She's managed to draw designs to improve them. As a result of Dorothea's rare desires, the only community of Christian women available to Dorothea cannot support her any better than her husband does. The women of Middlemarch avoid acquiring knowledge of anything that doesn't contribute to gossip, and they jealously compare what material comfort their husbands can provide for them. The notable exception to those materialist female gatherings is the cross-generation friendship of the most Catholically named Mary Garth with her older generation of friends, Mrs. Fairbrother, and her daughter, Miss Fairbrother, and her sister, the infinitely generous Henrietta Noble. The Noble Fairbrother women, as we might call them if we were looking for hints of monastic communities in the novel, sustain each other in intellectual activity, in economic restraint, and in devotion to the small acts of charity that their means allow. They're not a perfect trio, but rather a committed set of women, all single now, and living together for their common good under the economic support of the Reverend Camden Fairbrother, which is important, as we'll see soon. The narrator also makes clear the contrast between the social coherence of the church in Teresa's era of Catholic Reformation and the divisive nature of the church in Dorothea's decades. From the novel's early pages, we're told that Dorothea cannot accomplish an epic life because in the 1829 opening of the novel, the terms Protestant and Catholic are used as much for political as for spiritual identification. By stating that Middlemarch residents are, quote, still discussing Mr. Peel's late conduct on the Catholic question, the narrator places spiritual identity largely in the context of a political debate about the Catholic Relief Act of 1829, and hints that trivializing conversations on this debate frame Middlemarch views on the potential for reform through the 1830s. The Catholic Relief Act putatively lifted all restrictions placed on Catholics in the recusant acts of the Elizabethan era. However, the Victorian legislation mandated a separate oath of allegiance for Catholics who wanted to take public office, and it more fully articulated restrictions on Jesuits. Victorian Catholics after 1829 were permitted into secular institutions, but reform left them overtly marked as separated from their Protestant brothers and sisters in England. In choosing 1829 for her setting, that's to say, Eliot subtly calls her readers' attentions to the ways Protestant politicians took a stand against Catholicism, resisting not only so-called popery, but also the Catholic small-c Christian church. That more universal Christendom was the source of coherent social faith and order that gave, to use Eliot's term, the 16th century Teresa a framework from which to engage in her own reforms under spiritual directors and in the empowering limits of a defined community. The church, Eliot seems to say, was at its weakest in reforming power when it was an object of political reform. Eliot's assumptive posture in opening the prelude, that posture that says, who cares to know the history of man? All of us, of course, might have dwelt on the life of Teresa, is probably not a mere gesture, but a reminder to the novel's first readers of what they remembered of Teresa's biography. Echoes in Eliot's prelude of that other 19th century telling of Teresa's life that's now largely forgotten help us recover the particular hagiographical details that would come to mind for many Victorians. Eliot's journals make frequent references to the Christian art history of Anna Murphy Jameson, whom the novelist was reading as early as 1858 while she was composing her first novel, Adam Bede. Jameson's Legends of the Monastic Orders, with its attentions both to Teresa's biography and to representations of her in art galleries across Europe, was first published in 1850 and was about to enter its fifth edition when Middlemarch appeared in 1871. Like Eliot's references to Teresa, Jameson's account highlights the saint's childhood zeal evidenced in her wandering after the moors with her brother, and also her submission to spiritual directors in her decision to write her visions and her life. And you can see some of those parallels on the reverse side of your handout. I gave you some of Jameson because she's a little bit harder to find. Both works also share an emphasis on Teresa's enthusiastic and ardent nature, and the ways that her exceptional character mixed with thoroughly feminine principles. Though both Eliot and Jameson see Teresa as passionate and ardent, neither highlights Bernini's ecstatic or erotic character of Teresa. The Teresa these women see as a model for other women of their era is more marked by intellect, discipline, and social responsibility than she is by desire for attachment to a specific other, especially to a male other who might overwhelm her being. In a passage you don't have on your handout, and that I should say actually I have in my office by the generosity of Westmont's art department when they were given a bequest of a bunch of art books, and Lisa DeBoer found a full set of first edition Anna Jameson's series, Sacred and Legendary Art, and they are now sitting in my office. So if you want to see this quote in its natural habitat, come to my office and I'll be happy to share it with you. Jameson actually rails against Bernini's hypersexualized representation of Teresa. She calls it the grossest, the most offensive example. And it's that marble group of Bernini in the Santa Maria della Vittoria at Rome. The head of Teresa is that of a languishing nymph. The angel is a sort of eros. The whole has been significantly described as a parody of divine love. Okay. As the collection of etchings that Jameson herself created across editions of Legends of Monastic Order, and she kept returning to Teresa in these etchings, demonstrate, she does not object to representing Teresa as physically beautiful. She includes, for illustrative purposes, let me get back there, one sketch of Jameson from a Spanish picture that used to be in, formerly in the Louvre, she tells us. This is Jameson's own etching. Just to show the materialism that's often apparent in paintings of Teresa late in life, where Jameson thinks she was displayed in her illness as too corpulent and unattractive. She prefers an image that she reproduces by Bramantino of Teresa holding a cross. Jameson wants to resist, but she does not wants to resist sexualizing Teresa, Jameson does object to freezing Teresa in marble as in what she sees as an object of erotic pleasure for the male gaze. Teresa's beauty for Jameson must allow space to imagine the social and intellectual power of the historical saint and mystic. In one edition of the Legends, Jameson recasts the ecstatic scene that Bernini chooses, including several of the same elements, but keeping Teresa's posture of prayer at the center of the image. I keep hitting the shift button. From the early days of her own career, George Eliot read Jameson avidly. She returned to her histories of Christian art as she was writing Middlemarch, and the echoes of Jameson's Teresa in Eliot's Prelude and in her Dorothea are unmistakable, even in her more lyrical prose. Many Teresas have been born who found for themselves no epic life wherein there was a constant unfolding of far resonant action, perhaps only a life of mistakes, the offspring of a certain spiritual grandeur ill-matched with the meanness of opportunity, perhaps a tragic failure which found no sacred poet and sank unwept into oblivion. Eliot's narrative seems to acknowledge her reader's familiarity with Jameson's particular choices in representing Teresa, asking the readers of her prelude which of them, quote, has not smiled with some gentleness at the thought of a little girl walking forth one morning hand in hand with her still smaller brother to go and seek martyrdom in the country of the Moors. That gentle smile of memory might be prompted by knowledge of Jameson's earlier text, which shares several details with Eliot's. Significantly, both Jameson and Eliot note women's power for destruction in their frustrated aspirations as they think of contrast to Teresa in the modern day. Failed education, unrealistic vocational expectations, the pettiness of middle-class social claims, and devastating lack of support may all share culpability in rendering female heroism impossible in 19th century middle-class culture. Importantly for Jameson and for Eliot, as we see in Rosamund Vincy in Middlemarch, those circumstances cannot render all women powerless. Female power in intellect, in passion, in affection, when undeveloped, channeled, or trained in serious education, simply grows destructive. Repeatedly, Jameson's fundamental recognition in this social loss is in not helping talented women to thrive so that they might use their talents well. She insists on realist understandings of femininity throughout. Some women will only manage an idiosyncratic virtue, while other women will remain virtuous in a dutiful fashion, but will lack the moral courage to accomplish the kinds of virtuous acts Jameson sees as possible for active, educated women in the 19th century. Eliot's attention to the details of Jameson's writing and her reliance on Jameson's understanding of Catholic art attest to the cultural authority Jameson held among her contemporaries. Eliot might have disregarded Jameson even if she did not criticize her. Eliot did not suffer female fools wisely. One of her most famous essays in the Westminster Review is one called Silly Novels by Lady Novelists. And her ability to be very critical of Dorothea demonstrates that right in Middlemarch. An influence, we should note, that demonstrates the fruits of female intellectual community between Jameson and Eliot and the women around them. Eliot knew of Jameson beyond her written work through their joint interest in reforming the material conditions of women, promoting more opportunity for passionate and intelligent Victorian women like the fictional Dorothea to move beyond those tangled circumstances that could warp them. Jameson was, in fact, the adopted aunt for a group of younger women who became known as the Langham Place Circle after the offices they took to work for reform of marriage and property law and to create opportunities for women's employment and education. Those women included Barbara Lee Smith, the first to recognize George Eliot in print as Marianne Evans, Lewes, and her friend Bessie Rayner Parks, Adelaide Procter, and Mary Howitt, along with her daughter Anna Mary Howitt, who all began the lobbying effort that would become known as the Married Women's Property Movement in 1856 to reform British coverture laws. Coverture is the principle by which a woman's property legally became her husband's on marriage, because her civic and economic identity was seen to be covered by his identity. While marital property, the legal commentator Blackwood makes clear that married women could not both have and own property because that was a logical impossibility. Could not both have and be property, that was a logical impossibility. While marital property laws were only slowly reformed over a period of two decades, the gathering of energetic young authorial women in Langham Place accomplished several small gains in women's economic, educational, and employment privileges. Bessie Rayner Parks and Barbara Lee Smith were Eliot's close friends, and though the novelist clearly saw the need for reform of marriage laws, she remained on the edge of the lobbying movement to keep her own irregular marital status from hampering their work. So they asked for her signature on a petition and she refused to sign, not because she didn't believe in the petition, but because she knew that her name would not serve them well when most of the legal public knew that she was living with George Henry Lewes. Okay. Jameson was recognized by the press as one of their leaders. She was called the rabble-rouser wasn't the term, petticoat rebellion, the leader of a petticoat rebellion. And she too attempted to maintain some distance from the petitioning and editorial writing, though, because she lived in a long-term separation from her husband. Jameson carried a letter from her husband for most of her adult life after he moved to Canada, saying that she had permission to live separate from him. As a novelist, Eliot faced similar limits on her reforming powers. She could only reform one reader at a time. Not an entire order, as Teresa had done, or full legislative systems, as her friends at Langham Place were doing. In an age without the social structure of the church universal, Eliot can only muster a prelude to a reforming act. The deep reform Eliot saw the need for, Middlemarch exists, was not possible through literature alone under the reign of 19th century's domestic ideology, and it was imaginable only in some cross-fertilization of artistic forms available to the highly educated. In her prelude, she presses the limits of the novel's genre, playing a prophetic role in calling for richer, more interdisciplinary forms of literature, and only striking the earliest chords for social or spiritual reformation of the Victorian community. Her responses to marriage law reform from within the limits of the novel's form have earned Eliot charges of political quietism, with generations of feminists noting that she seems to relegate women who attempt to forge public roles for themselves to the dubious honor, in the words of Middlemarch's conclusion, of living faithfully a hidden life and resting in unvisited tombs. That charge of quietism may miss the form Eliot's resistance to Victorian social structures took. Jameson, on the other hand, would return to writing about women's religious communities and the opportunities they offered for female development, completely independent of the realm of imaginative literature and art she analyzes in her early writing. The female communities that Jameson encountered outside of England hold value because they give women distance from the compulsion of bourgeois public opinion about propriety. She actually wrote Sisters of Charity at Home and Abroad and the Communion of Labor, about women living in public together in convents and beguinages across Europe and being able to support each other in that way. Those two lectures came out just before Jameson's death. Middlemarch, as it reaches narrative conclosure, suggests one of two possibilities for an alternative to the marriage plot as master plot for women, or to what we might call the convent plot. The first is that Eliot wholeheartedly believed her own skeptical assessment in the prelude that there could, quote, be no modern-day Teresas. She simply can't imagine, that's to say, a successful, productive, happy, and motivated single life for a woman. So all women must marry, whether that marriage is traditional or illicit, as Eliot's herself was, and whether or not it's happy. A second possibility, though, seems more apt to me for an author of her mental capacity. She could imagine it, and she wasn't positive her readers were ready to. So she tried out the monastic plot with a fictional male alter ego first. And I just want to play out a little bit of that plot with you before I finish tonight. I know that we're winding up on time. Okay. It's undeniably the case that the most consciously single character in Middlemarch occupies a less central position than Dorothea, and he's also male. He also happens to be the character that is most forgotten in the novel. The grounds for my argument about a monastic plot do not rest solely on Fairbrother's singleness. With its typical narrative complexity, the novel invites us to consider this model of monasticism by linking Fairbrother in some sly ways with St. Teresa's reforming partner and spiritual director, St. John of the Cross. This is not a Jameson etching. This is just one of the most common images of St. John of the Cross. Okay. Author of The Dark Night of the Soul. St. John of the Cross was Teresa's partner in Reformation and also her spiritual director. Fairbrother, that's to say, is as much a St. John of the Cross as Dorothea is a St. Teresa. The linking of these two characters reflects Eliot's interest in reimagining and reforming social bonds by representing a cross-gender friendship that does more than any other relationship in the novel to reinvigorate hope and certain kinds of faith in various inhabitants of Middlemarch. Fairbrother's alliance with Teresa's spiritual companion and St. John of the Cross, who coined the term Dark Night of the Soul, has his own experience of religious crisis. And it's clearly relevant to the climactic chapter when Dorothea experiences a dark night of the soul. The last person she sees before she has that collapse on the floor of her boudoir is Fairbrother, who has recognized she's in pain and leads her to her room and then leaves her alone. Dorothea awakes a new person from that experience. It's the last time we see Fairbrother in the novel. His last visible act of the plot connects him to Dorothea as Teresa and caps a series of analogies between the pairs of friends of the Carmelite reformers. Fairbrother is as much a modern-day John of the Cross as Dorothea is a modern-day Teresa. He's interested in natural history, what we would call biology and science. And he converses with Dorothea on the possible histories of creatures that converse compendiously with their antennae. In another instance, he's great friends with the medical reformer Lydgate, and he notices that rather than keeping his study full of theology, though he is one of the most popular preachers in town and scriptural commentary, Fairbrother's room contains, quote, a neat fitting up of drawers and shelves for specimens and the bookcases filled with expensive illustrated books on natural history. He has managed to combine his calling toward the natural sciences with his calling to the church that continues to allow him to support his female relatives who are economically dependent on him. Even when speaking of his nemesis Bulstrode to Lydgate, Fairbrother demonstrates Christian charity. He tells Lydgate, who hears him at his frankest, quote, I don't like the set he belongs to. They're a narrow, ignorant set and do more to make their neighbors uncomfortable than to make them better. But then he goes on to praise Bulstrode's support of the town's only running hospital. Though he remains adamantly single, Fairbrother's intellectual skills and his faith commitment give him sufficient strength to avoid being drawn into Rosamond Vincey's chain, which makes him unusual in the city of Rosamond, and yet he's clear-eyed about her. He believes that Rosamond was, as he calls her, an amiable, docile creature, though he always thought her rather uninteresting. That marks him as the only man in Middlemarch to think so. He tells Lydgate in a conversation about the hospital chaplaincy, which he loses rather unfairly, I don't translate my own convenience into other people's duties. Whether he turns his attention toward the novel's pattern of marriageable women, or Fred Vincey, or Ladislaw, or Lydgate, or Bulstrode, or the members of the clergy community, Fairbrother sees others clearly, yet without the egoism that makes them means to his own end. Tellingly, these reminders of Fairbrother's internal resources of intellect, of charity, and of faith surface when the Reverend has made the most difficult sacrifice of Mary Garth's love. That sacrifice makes clear that Fairbrother does not remain single out of lack of romantic or even sexual interest. Rather, he subjugates those interests to others, perhaps deeper commitments, but certainly prior ones in his vocation and in the community, which he allows his female family to remain together in. His integrity and his willingness to sacrifice his own happiness for the good of others mark his character consistently, though, or perhaps, perhaps because many readers of the novel forget him. Have you ever noticed that the good characters are the ones we tend to forget first? And I think that's part of the plight of Fairbrother. Without his presence, though, several of the final hopeful points of narrative closure in the novel would not happen. Self-denying from the beginning, Reverend Fairbrother is a bachelor whose commitment to living in community with his mother, sister, and aging aunt limits not only his social relations, but also severely strains his finances as their main source of economic support. He does gamble, and we find in the novel when Dorothea makes a more profitable living available to him that he immediately stops gambling. Gambling was one of the ways he supported his mother, his aunt, and his sister until he no longer needed the money. The narrator does not leave it to a reader to conclude the value of Fairbrother in the community in Middlemarch. Across the board, characters praise him for his integrity. Fairbrother's combined virtues may remove him from the resolution of the marriage plot, but they also link him to various other possibilities for resolution in a novel. In another instance of import, when Lydgate faces the scandal of Bulstrode and Raffles, Dorothea inspires hope in the shattered medical man, not merely by claiming his good opinion might generally be restored, but by assuring him specifically that, quote, Fairbrother will believe in him. The Reverend's skills with methods of gaining knowledge give Fairbrother particular integrity and respect in Middlemarch. The esteem Fairbrother garners in Middlemarch and the good he does suggests that Eliot both imagined and narrated the positive conflation of knowledge and of singleness in community. She may not have found a central place for that conflation within the generic confines of the novel, however. The narrator's persistent, albeit subtle, attention to Fairbrother's successes in the provincial community provide evidence for the idea that the challenges in connecting singleness, faith, and intellect in Victorian culture may result from our cultural training as much as from the inherent elements of marriage or of singleness. Part of that cultural training for Eliot's readers, of course, ironically, came from the novels they consumed that gave them life narratives. So if we set Fairbrother and the lacking Dorothea aside to consider plentiful Teresas as possibilities for narratives, where do we look? With centuries of crowns, we might consider Bernini's sculpted Teresa in ecstasy and the various ideological iterations of Bernini's Teresa that various disciplines of history in the academy since have enjoyed. With Jameson, I think we might do better to look elsewhere. For instance, more recently, I would recommend, if you're interested in Teresa, that you look at the biography of former Archbishop Rowan Williams, a telling of Teresa that I think could only be written after Middlemarch. Considering these Teresas from our oddly monastic corner of the academy brought me, it might surprise you to know, to the queer theorist Michael Cobb, as he sought alternatives to the ideology of the couple, turning from the crowd mentality that Hannah Arendt identified as enabling totalitarianism. Cobb might have been speaking for Eliot's later-born Teresas, for Jameson, for Eliot. And for many Westmont students. When Cobb states that, to indulge in the couple form is to indulge in the crowd. Only when we move away from the ideology of the couple, Cobb challenges us, can we, quote, then discover figures that are alone but not lonely, not menaced by the feelings of loneliness that push us into the couple. Or into any crowd. As a means of exploring that aloneness beyond Cobb, I find myself considering Teresa's convent as a different direction beyond sex, which I might add is not the same thing as without sex. What does it mean to choose the convent, or at least an extended community other than the nuclear family, as Teresa and John of the Cross did, as a particular alternative to the crowd? How might we find a 21st century version of that vibrant intellectual and spiritual structure and restraint in the community of a Christian liberal arts college? Though we can easily forget it in our lives as faculty, students, and staff at Westmont, I suspect many of us know the visceral pleasure of that heart-racing, stomach-churning curiosity that Eliot's narrator assumes we have. More bodily pleasure, more instances of sensational ideas to indulge our appetites. As the narrator of Middlemarch seems to know, an infinite number of narrative trajectories exist away from the crowd if we will imagine them. Narrative trajectories vast in territory between the epic life and the unvisited grave. When somebody's story gets told in good fiction, what's intriguing is neither the general trend toward marriage nor the particular diversion into singleness. Eliot's Teresa and her Dorothea remind us that while legal reform is a matter of justice for the oppressed, reform of imagination that allows people to re-see the possibilities for thriving rather than pressing them into some form must matter as well. She also reminds us that such reimagining is not a solo or even a lonely act. Reimagining happens in individuals or single people, single readers, and makes the strongest reforming impact when many of us begin to imagine single people not as unmarried, but as part of a cohesive social structure, whether that structure be a monastic one, or a liberal arts college one, or an extended family, or a church, rather than merely understanding some adults as not married. That revised narrative for Eliot is at the heart of marriage reform. Thank you.